Hey, welcome to Church Experience. Thank you so much for spending part of your weekend with us. Now's a great time to grab your pens and weeklies and head to your seats if you haven't already, because the service starts in 90 seconds.
Welcome, Church Experience.
It's so good to see you all. We all desire to belong, and this is the best kind of place to belong to.
If it's your first time here at CE, you are our VIP. You're important to God and to us, and as a church family, we would love to say,
Welcome home.
Please take a minute to fill out the response card at the bottom of your weekly you were handed when you walked in today. You can tear it off and drop it in the offering bucket when it passes you at the end of the service. That way we can get to know you. You know, we have another important thing that we would love to take a moment to do in service if everyone would go ahead and take their phones out. Every year we do an annual survey at CE because we care about what you think. Can you open your camera app and go ahead and scan this QR code on the screen?
Actually, can we keep the code on the screen for just a minute so everyone has a chance to scan it? What if, while you take a minute to fill out the survey, I'll take the opportunity to tell you about one of our CE ministries that is extremely special to us.
That sounds like a good idea, and I bet I know what ministry you're gonna say, since we both care about it so much.
Kid Experience! You know what? I have an even better idea. Since everyone is filling out their surveys, we have a minute to show them a sneak peek of what someone who would find our KE YouTube channel online that would have an amazing way to see what happens on Sunday.
Let's do it.
We are so glad you have joined us.
Welcome to the Kid Experience YouTube channel. This place is a fun-filled, impacting, unforgettable, dynamic, laughter-filled fun, always focused on pushing us forward in our walk with Jesus. Although we aim to help each kid understand how to grow in their walk with God, we adults, we like to have fun too.
Whether you're in a place like Florida, Pennsylvania, or even hanging out in your own home, while you're here, you'll get to join our Kid Experience family and join in some of the favorite things that we have, like learning from Kid Experience services with fun themes.
My plan for us today, let's make some cookies!
No way! I love making cookies! I'm so excited!
Experience, I'm your pilot, Captain Adam, and we're going to take a few of our CE friends on a trip to Hawaii.
Dancing to our favorite Jesus-centered song.
Praising my God, he's better than good.
What's up?
Memorizing impacting Bible verses with motions to cement it into our minds.
God, you are my God. I want to follow you. Psalm 63:1.
Participating in thought-provoking questions to help us think through what we've learned.
It is time to reflect on what we have learned. Our first question today is, what is one way you can help your family out this week? And our final question is, why do you think God wants us to help each other?
Not to mention the fun games we play together.
That's right, it's our favorite time of the week.
Game time! Did any of you miss that? If you did, let me repeat myself. Game time! Tie your laces tight and put your game faces on because this competition is gonna be fierce.
All right, KE friends, you get to do your first competition this summer. It's a chicken dance-off.
Wait, did I just hear that right? A chicken dance-off?
Oh, yeah. I was an amazing princess, and you were a knight, and we got to live in this incredible castle with all of my family and all the other knights.
Wait. If I'm gonna be a knight in a castle, it needs to be way more heroic like this.
Absolutely not. I'm making up the story, and I'm the princess, and I want a BEA beautiful castle.
No. I'm not gonna be fighting dragons and be heroic knight in a castle looking like that.
We'll just see about that.
I don't think so.
No, absolutely not. No.
Can we please settle on this heroic castle?
I personally love that there is new, good content each week.
All right, here we go. I can talk to God.
So you're telling me that Joseph was humble because he gave God all the credit?
That's right, partner.
No. This is how they do it.
Wow, God's word really is like pure gold.
The fun never stops. Since I know that you don't want to miss out, will you do us a favor? Right now, click on the subscribe button because we don't want you to miss out on anything fun here in Kid Experience.
As our KE family often says, KE is a place to be.
Well, you've seen a piece of what happens every week, and this may be a place where you would love to use your giftings, talents, and love for kids. If so, you could write kids on your response card, or we'll have a sign up by the red carpet if you're interested in asking questions or joining the team.
I know for me personally, being a part of this ministry has blessed my life in so many ways. I hope and pray some of you jump on board in Kid Experience.
Well, if you aren't done, keep filling out that survey, but let's go ahead and grab our pens and weeklies and jump into today's message.
In the darkness we were weighed without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in
God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the you now to do the same thing for me. Yes, for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing faithfulness. shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Yes. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. You heard your children then, you hear your children now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You were providing. You are providing now. You are the same God.
You are the same.
You are the same.
Yes.
God.
You moved in power then. God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same.
Heavenly Father, we just call upon your name, Lord, and we are grateful that you are the Alpha and the Omega. You transcend time. You are timeless and can always be counted on. And Lord, your promises reign true back then, and they still reign true to this day. And we can call upon you for the miracles that we need in our life, for the faith that we need, Lord. You are always there for us, and we just give you all the praise and glory. It's in your mighty name we pray. Amen.
Hey. Good morning. It's great to be here. We're week 46 as a church planted, and it's really cool to see what God's doing, you know. And as our pastors would say in Johannesburg, it's like each Sunday it's just another brick in the wall. We just, you know, you just keep going. You just keep going. Long obedience in the same direction. And sometimes it might be more people, sometimes less people, but we just keep going. We just keep going. Long obedience in the same direction. You know, sometimes we're going to have great weather, and sometimes it's going to look like we just start building an ark because there's lots of rain. But we keep going. You know, I remember someone said to me, you know, you don't judge or look at a church like week on week. You do it like year after year. You know what I mean? It's like you don't be like, oh, it was the church is going well because there were, you know, many people or whatever. Or no, it's like we're in this for the long haul. And I hope you got more of, you're going to see more of those type of pictures, you know, as we keep going. But you know, it's such a joy to see God working. Isn't it a joy? I'm loving seeing what God is doing in this church. I'm loving to see the discipleship that is happening. I'm loving to see the fruit that's coming. And so last week we finished that series about Aim Higher. And at the end, I kind of mentioned about you know, God's providence, his protection, his presence. And you know, I said we'll go through it a bit this morning, but I want to just start off by saying thank you. A few weeks, you probably would have gotten, those that have decided to, that have partnered with us financially, you would have gotten a giving statement about, you know, your giving that you can use for tax purposes and all that. I just wanted to start off by saying thank you. Thank you so much for all the generosity that you guys have towards us. I know that that's one way that you partner with us is financially, and there's a lot of other ways, but it's, for me, coming out of corporate, I know what it's like to earn, to work hard for a living. And so to give that, I know it's hard for a lot of us. And I know it's a journey. I get it. It's a journey. You know, for a long time, I was holding on to it too much. But it's one of the areas, especially in my life and maybe for a lot of us, we trust God with a lot of things, but not that. It's like, Lord, I know you're going to come through in these ways, but money, no, I'm going to hold on to it, you know. But I want to start off by saying I will never ask you to go to a place that I'm not willing to go myself. Whether it's money, whether it's faith, whether it's taking that leap of faith, whether it's trusting in that, whatever, I'm never going to ask you to go to a place that I'm not willing to go. Because that would just be, as a shepherd, it's pointless. I have to be challenged enough or have the faith enough to go to a place that God is challenging you to go to. And I want to tell you a story about how this is even challenging me. So, you know, we went a few weeks ago to the Jesus Culture Pastors Conference. We went to it last year. Last year we went, and our whole trip there was sponsored. The flights were sponsored. The conference was sponsored. We stayed at someone's homes. It was, and so the whole trip was sponsored, which was amazing. And so, you know, we didn't have a church yet. We, you know, there was like a lot of challenges. And so I was like, just trusting God. And I remember just in between one of the sessions, just chatting to these guys that were around us. And there was like an older gentleman with, it looked like four sons or four brothers, you know. And they lived in like rural Montana, somewhere up there, I think. And so we just started chatting to them about our story. I'm like, oh, we don't have a church. We want to launch soon. And, you know, this was last year. And so we might have found a building. You know, we meet in our home at the moment. And we're just sharing our story, how we, you know, left Johannesburg and came here. And the one son just, he took out his wallet and gave me some lunch money. And I just felt so touched. Like, here's a man who just, I didn't say like, hey, do you have some lunch money for me? Like, it's not my style. I don't do that. I trust God for my provision. But the guy just took out and he says, I just wanted to give you some money for lunch. And I just felt so blessed by him, but also by God, by using him to just remind me, Warren, I've got you. I've got you. I'll provide. You know, even a small thing like to get some money, I've got you. Don't worry, you know. And it meant the world to me. And I'd love to say that I thought about it for long afterwards, but I probably thought about it for another week after it happened. And after that, completely forgot about it. Like, did not remember it at all. Isn't that what happens sometimes? We thank you, Lord, for this. This is so great for this provision that you're giving me is wonderful. And then a week later, we forget. And we forget so much that then the next time there's a challenge, like, Lord, why aren't you coming through? Why aren't you answering my prayer? You know? And because we forget the goodness that he's done. And so I totally forgot about this story. And even though it impacted me so deeply when it happened, I totally forgot about it. You know, because I was too busy worrying about other things. And I forgot about it until this conference we went to, the same, like so a year later, and I'm, you know, worship is starting, and you know, you're looking around, saying hello to people, whatever, and I look right at the back, and I see them, and they're there, the brothers and the dad, and in that moment, I just felt such guilt, like, Lord, I'm so sorry that I forgot, remember that story, and I was just, while I was worshiping, I was just saying, Lord, please forgive me, because you provided in such a way, even though it wasn't about the money, it was just about how you were showing me that you've got me, you know. And I was just like, I was just worshiping, and I was like, Lord, I'm so sorry, please forgive me. While I was worshiping, I felt God say to me, I want you to give money back to the gentleman. So I said, okay. I said, okay, how much, you know? He says, everything in your wallet. So I, the day before, when we flew out, I went to the, and I drew a whole lot of money for the week, you know? And God said, I want you to give everything in your wallet. And I said to God, are you sure? Are you sure? I don't know if I'm hearing you correctly, because, you know, I'd like some for us. You know, we still need to eat, you know what I mean? Like, we still need some. And I was like wrestling with God. Do any of you ever do that? Wrestling with him, like, Lord, are you sure you want me to? I don't know. It would be nice if I keep some back. And if I God just say, all of it. It's like, okay. But then I'm still wrestling. Like, even afterwards, I feel that. I'm still wrestling with him. This is me, right? This was a few weeks ago. Still wrestling. Like, Lord, are you sure? Maybe I misheard you wrong. I don't know. So then it was, we had like some breakout sessions. And I see, there was, like I said, there were four sons, maybe a little bit younger than us, but you know, adults. And so I see the three of the sons sitting there. And I thought it was one of the sons. So I had all the, I took the money out of my wallet and I put it in my top pocket here. Well, I put it in my pocket so it's easy to give to him. And so I went and sat in front of him. And I said, listen, I don't know if you remember me from last year. And he said, no, I do not. So I was like, this is what happened, you know. And you know, you gave me some money for lunch, and it was just, it touched my heart, and I feel so bad because I totally forgot about it. And then while I was worshiping, this is what God was telling me, and he wanted me to give you some money back. And he's like, I don't know what you're telling me. Like, I don't remember it at all. I said, I know it was a while ago, and, you know, and so eventually I just take the money and I put it out in his top pocket like this, and I give it to him, and I walk away. And then there's like a break in the sessions, you know, and so then I tell Jen the story, and Jen's like, oh, wow, that's pretty cool, and did you keep any of yourself? No, I'm kidding, Jen didn't ask that. You know? So, yeah. Did you get a slip, you know, like a tax deductible slip? You know, so I said, no, this is the case. And so, okay, cool. You know, if that's what God asked you to do. And I felt guilty because I was questioning God. I felt guilty because I'd forgotten his goodness. And then I felt guilty because I'm like questioning, what does he want me to do, you know? And so I give it to him. And then I was like, okay, Lord, that's cool. And so then after, like in the afternoon, we had another breakout session and we chatted to the guy who was sharing. And next thing, the other brother, so there were three brothers, the other brother comes running to me with his wife. And he says, it was me. So I was like, oh, wow, because I couldn't remember which one it was. He says, it was me, I got your money. He says, I was like, did you get all of it? You know what I mean? Did your brother like keep some, you know? So he says, it was me, I remember you from last year. You guys were starting to, you know what I mean? So we're having this dialogue and he says to me, He says, thank you so much. He says, this last season has been really rough. Like I said, they're in like rural America, and they had to do some work or something. And he said he told me him and his wife were there, and he said, I have $40 left in my bank account. So you've got no idea how much like this means to me. And then I felt guilty then, because I wish I had more. You know what I mean? And so, you know, I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for your generosity. I know it's tough. I know it is. But what I've realized in this journey is that God's presence is always going to be greater than God's providence. God's, you know, just his how he's blessing us, his provision. His presence is always going to be. In my life, in this church's life, we always have to go after him. Always have to go after his presence. His provision is wonderful. It's wonderful to be blessed by God, isn't it? It's wonderful. We, amen, hallelujah, we want more, Lord. But more than that, I want your presence. More than what you can give me, I just want you. More than the answer to prayers, all that stuff, all the stuff that I'm pleading you for, Lord, more than that, I just want your presence. So as a church, that's what this church is always going to be about. If it ever isn't, come and speak to me. If you know what I mean, if I ever make this church about me or whatever the case is, or it's a big deal, or do you know what I mean? Then if it, this church, our vision always has to be the presence of God, being with him and so I will never ask you to go to a place that I'm not willing to go. And so I'm going after his presence. Every time we come together, I pray and I contend, I say, Lord, please, will your your presence dwell with us this morning, Lord Jesus. Whether there's many of us or a few of us, I pray that your presence will be here, that you, the Holy Spirit, that you will speak to us. That is my focus. That's what we're always going to go after. And so I'm encouraged by that. And there's a verse in Psalm 46, verse 10, that says, "Be still and know that I am God." That's what we're going to go through this morning. But this is a piece of scripture that is a bit challenging, isn't it? It kind of startles us a bit. What is happening here? And Psalm 46 was happening at a time of war. They were in war. There was an enemy that were literally about to start attacking them. And so they were worried. And so you can just imagine the tenseness in the camp. You know, you can imagine all the clanking of the equipment, of the armor. You can imagine the stress that's happening because they know that maybe any moment, any day now, the enemy's going to come and attack us. And so there's this anxiety, there's a stress that's happening. And then right in the middle of this psalm, it says, "Be still and know that I am God." Martin Luther said this is his favorite psalm in the whole Bible. But right in the middle, it says, "Be still and know that I'm God." The rest of the psalm, we're not going to unpack the whole thing, but the rest of the psalm is all written in like the third person. And then right here, it's God saying, "Be still and know that I'm God." So we're going to unpack this. And there's two commands here. We're going to unpack it. The first one is to be still. That's the first command. The second command is to know that I am God. Those are the two ones, right? And so when it says to be still, it's to cease striving. It's literally, at the time, the metaphor that the Jewish people would use is to literally put your hands on the side of your and just not do anything. Like, that's it. And I know it's, when we look at this, when we say to be still, we're like, "Oh, I could do that, Warren. I can do that on the couch later today. I can be still. That's awesome, isn't it?" That's what we're talking about. We're going to be talking about something totally different. But it's, to be still is a choice. It's a choice. We it's not just going to happen. We have to proactively go after it. We have to, you know, in the world that we find ourselves, the busyness of life, we have to really be conscious of the fact to be still. Jen and I, we have to guard our Sabbath, the day that we can rest. And there's still lots to do. I mean, we don't just switch off and nothing. But we have to find time to just fill up again. And that looks different for all of us. I get it. But you have to be very aware that I need time to just be still, to rest in His presence, to dwell in His presence. I need to, because we live in a world that's just so busy. We crazy busy all the time. There's so much things that we get that needs to get done. We're a generation that's just filled with multitasking. We've got so many things happening at one time. We almost like celebrate busyness, don't we? You know, if someone says they're busy, it's, "Oh, well done. Okay, you must be quite... you must be quite good. You must be quite fancy if you're busy all the time." I remember my one friend in Johannesburg, whenever we asked him how his work was going, he's like, "No, it's cool. It's not too busy." And at first I was thinking, "What? What do you mean?" And he was pretty senior in his work. "No, it's all right. I'm not too busy. It's pretty cool." I was like, "Well, that sounds pretty good." Because the rest of us, it's like, the busier we are, the higher up we are. The more of a title we have. You know what I mean? The busyness, right? And so we live in this place where this generation is so busy, and yet there's so many people out there looking for meaning, that their life is empty. They're trying to find all these things in different things. They've got so many things happening, but yet they're empty and they're shallow. You know, we celebrate busyness. We also can celebrate how we can communicate with each other. You know, if you want to come and find me, you can find me on my phone, on iMessage, on Facebook, on Snapchat, on Smoke Signal, on Carrier Pigeon, all the different things that you can do. You can find me. It's like, if you want to get hold of me, you can get hold of me in any one of those ways, right? There's so many different ways that we can communicate with each other. And at the same time, if you can't get hold of me, I have auto replies and this and that. And sometimes if someone doesn't reply soon enough to us, then we might, "Why aren't they replying? Why aren't they replying yet?" Because do they not know how busy I am? I asked them a question. Why aren't they answering their question? Do you know what I mean? And so we in this generation that's just so busy, we've overloaded our lives and we've lost control of it because there's so much happening all the time. Think of a computer, right? So remember the old computer we used to have? I mean, I would pray every morning that computer would work, because I would click the Pro Presenter that we use. I would click it, and the computer would basically say to me, "Are you sure? Are you sure you want that program to open? I don't know. I'm going to just sit here and maybe open it for you." I mean, it's not saying it to me verbally, but I know what it's thinking. You know what I mean? And then eventually it would, you know, acquiesce and be like, "Okay, I'll open it for you." But then it'll take time, you know? And sometimes our lives is like that. We've got so many tabs open, so many things open in our minds that we end up, like, the only thing we could do is like control or delete and switch it off and on again. You know? I remember early on in this church plant, we've 46 weeks in, but early on, I was just running so hard that you remember the one day I came here and I had no voice? Do you remember that? And I remember just feeling depleted. I had no voice. I literally spent 2 days in bed after that, because it was like my body's way of saying, you need to be still. You're running too hard. You're trying to do too many things. And I just needed those 2 days just to sit in bed and be like, oh, okay, I can do it now. And sometimes that's our bodies know, before we know, before our minds and our bodies know, you need to relax now. You need to be still, right? And so we've got all these tabs open, all these different things, but God in everything wants to get our attention. In everything, he wants to get our attention. If you think about Jesus, Jesus' earthly ministry was 3.5 years. 3.5 years he did his earthly ministry, right? And think about all he accomplished in 3.5 years. Google told me he did 37 miracles. It's a lot of miracles, 3.5 years. He, you know, helped the blind see. He raised the dead alive. He helped the paralyzed to walk again. He did all these miracles, all these things. He was always, but yet he never seemed to be in a hurry. Never seemed to be in a hurry. You know, he'd be on his way to someone would call him today, can you go visit that place? There's someone there. And so he was going there. And then while he was there was an interruption. Oh, there's this lady who touched me. And okay, let's help this. And he was always interrupted. But he wasn't like, can you just not interrupt me now? I'm on my way here. No, he never did that. Now, if you had to give me if you had to say, this is what you need to accomplish in 3.5 years, I would have been like, there's so much I need to do. I need to go straight away. I need to go off the blocks fast. I need to do all these different things, and there's so much to do, and I would have been rushing in this. I would have maybe opened up an Excel spreadsheet and put the different tabs on the bottom, the one whom Jesus loves, the 3, the 12, the 70, and done VLOOKUPs and pivot tables and all this type of stuff, and okay, you're going to do this and this and this and this. I would have done all of that. It would have been miserable. I would have been an absolute wreck. I would have been so miserable. I mean, you can imagine, I would be like, okay, disciples, are you going? We have to go to the other side of the lake now to heal some lepers. And if we don't leave now, they're going to leave. And so we need to go. Come, hurry up. Stop dilly-dallying. You need to hurry. You know? No, Jesus was never in a hurry. He was busy. Look at what he accomplished in 3.5 years. Huge stuff. Massive miracles. But yet he was never in a hurry. He was busy, but never in a hurry. Didn't allow it to. You know, Christ never did that. We are in a society that we're running on the proverbial hamster wheel. We're just running, but we're not going anywhere. We just keep running. It takes us, you know, God wants to get our attention. He wants us to be still. You see, but when I can't be still, there's a war happening. The enemy's coming. No, but just be still. No, but I can't. I've got so much to do, but just be still. Yeah, but Warren, you don't understand. You don't know what I have to go through. You don't know all the pressure on me. Just be still. Yeah, but that, what do you mean? I'm just sit down and do nothing and just passively just wait? No, it's not saying that at all. There's an activity here. He's asking us to do something. He's calling us to do something. Well, what is he calling us to do? And know that I am God. He's not telling us to just be still and that's the end of it. He's saying be still and know that I am God. He wants us to be present in his presence. Far too often, I know in my life we rush in so much that I'm present, but I'm not. Have you ever done that with kids? You know, you and your kids, you may be playing something with your kids, playing Lego or something, and your kids having a long conversation to you, and you've got your mind somewhere else. You are thinking about, I don't know, whatever else you're thinking of, and eventually like 10, 15 minutes, dad, oh, what? Did you hear anything I just said in the last like 15 minutes? Oh, no, what did you say? Because we're there, but we're not. Ever happened? Has it ever happened to you? We're there, but we're not. I remember the first time when I got the first iPhone. Remember the iPhone when it came out many years ago? And I was in a work meeting and a big boardroom, and we had like a conference call with the other sites, and I'm just staring at my phone, just thinking this thing is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. You remember? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I just use my head. I use my fingers. Remember? Because it's crazy. And I remember looking at this thing and just staring at it, and the people on the other side of the call, they asked me a question, and I totally didn't hear it because I'm too busy staring. And then they asked me again, and then I heard it, but I was like, what did you ask again? I couldn't hear you because I think the signal's bad. And then they asked it, then I kind of answered it back. But I was there, but I wasn't. I was present, but I was present with something else. And sometimes we maybe like it with our relationship with God. Lord, I'm here, aren't I? Can you just answer my prayers now? Because I've got somewhere else to go. And so if you can just answer my prayers now, if you can speak to me now, then that'll be great. God's, no, just dwell. Just be still. I love the word dwell. I've been dwelling on it a while now. Dwell. I've been just, what does it mean to dwell with him? You know? It's like, and that's, it won't just happen. You have to be aware of it. You have to contend for it. Because the world is such a busy place. Jen and I, like I said to Jen the other day, I don't think we've ever been this busy in our life ever. You know? Because before, I could just, you know, close my laptop and that's me done for the day. Now, like, there's always stuff going on. There's always, do you know what I mean? There's always stuff. Don't feel bad for me because I'm loving it. But my mind's always switched on. I'm always busy doing something. I'm always busy thinking about it or praying or seeking Him or asking Him for prayers or praying for you guys. I'm always praying. I'm always seeking. I'm always busy. My mind never switches off. But I'm still finding time to dwell, to be still with Him. I don't just want to go to Him seek His provision or seek His prayers, or, like to seek that stuff. I want to go to Him just to spend time with Him. You know? And He's always speaking. Are we listening? Are we listening to what He's saying? He's inviting us to the most dynamic relationship with Himself. He's reminding us to just be, if you think, oh, I'd be still, He's basically saying, just stop. Just look at me. Just look at me. Just stop what you're doing. Just be still. Just be still in my presence. Just sit with me for a while. That's what He's saying. Just be still and know that I'm God. Be still. You might say, yeah, well, I've got a relationship with God. That's cool. I'm good. I'm here, aren't I? That's awesome. Praise God. You know, Lord, Warren, I've been saved. I'm going to heaven. That's amazing. Praise God for that. But I think there's so much more that He's inviting us into. I think that when we get saved, it's the beginning of our relationship with Him. It's not the end. It's the beginning of what He's doing. I think there's so much fruit, so much discipleship, so much stuff that comes out after that decision that a lot of us, I don't know, we don't want to go after it. We don't want to. But God wants to. And I think He wants to help us to move past maybe even a superficial relationship with Him, maybe even an intellectual relationship with Him. We know the right scriptures. We know the right doctrine. Maybe, but there's so much more than that He's offering us. He wants us to have a relationship with Him, an experience, not just a head knowledge, but a heart knowledge with Him. You know, one of so if we had to ask, what kind of relationship do you have with your Father? You know, you don't have to tell me, but just ask yourself, okay, what type of relationship do I have with Him? You can just be honest with yourself. Do I have a good relationship with Him? Did it used to be good? Were there times where it was good and now not so much? What is your relationship like with your Father? I mean, has it been a while since you felt Him molding you? Like like in Scripture, it talks about the potter. Has it felt like a while since He's been molding you into Jesus' image? Has it been a while? Maybe you feel like it's been a while since He's answered your prayers. I don't know. Maybe it's been a while since you just felt His presence. You know, has it been a long time since you've just been intentional to seek Him? And when last did you have a good, like, did you weep? Did you weep over Him? When last did you just have a good cry over just His presence, about what He's doing? Make sense? This happened to me on Friday morning. Friday morning, the boys were off school, and I said to Jen, I just want to go, just drive and just go sit in the car park and just spend time with my Father. And it was just Him and I, and I'm just weeping because I was just like, Lord, You are such a good Father, because He's revealing things to me now that I've never had before. And I'm just overwhelmed by His presence. I'm just in tears because I'm like, Lord, You are such a good Father. Like, I'm just overwhelmed by what He's doing in my life and in our lives and all the rest. And it just overwhelms me. Like, when last did that happen in your life? When last did you just feel that? Lord, I'm seeing You so clearly now. I've never seen You this clearly. Like, does that happen in your life? Does it feel like, the thing is the more it happens, the more you want it to happen. I need to spend more time with my Father. I need to be still more, because can I tell you, any moment that you spend in prayer or with your Father, it will never be wasted, ever. Never be wasted. You can be in a car on the way to a meeting. You can literally spend 5 minutes in the car just by yourself, just seeking Him and just praying. Like, Lord, I could tell You that's not wasted. You can go for a walk by yourself and just thank Him. Never wasted. That time that you have with your Father, it's never wasted. You know, I think it's probably one of my greatest desires for my kids is more, it's salvation, obviously, but more than that, that they know God, that they know that God loves them, that God has a plan for them, that God comforts them when they're struggling. God corrects them. God prunes them. That they know that God is active and working in their life. That they know that God is for them. That God wants to bless them. That God wants to lead and guide them. That's my greatest desire for my kids is that. And I suppose it's probably my greatest fear, is that if they don't, you know, because I'm aware now that, you know, they call it PKs, pastor's kids. A lot of pastor kids leave the church. Because they've seen the underbelly of the church. They've seen the good and the bad and all the messy bad, the stuff that a lot of other people aren't exposed to. They see it. And they see how, you know, they could see the toll that it could happen on their folks. And so they're thinking, well, when I grow up, I don't want any part of that. It's probably my greatest fear. And so I'm very intentional not to include them in a lot of things, but also to just have fun with them. Just to do things that is like just not church things. Do you know what I mean? I can just laugh with them and just spend time with them and protect them because I want them to know that God is real in so many ways. And so when we pray as a family and we celebrate together, when God answers prayers, we're like, thank you, Lord, that you answered those prayers. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you know that I don't have to take my life so seriously with them. You know, that I'm a father first, that I love them and I look after them and I want to provide for them. And the wonderful thing is, as they see the faith coming out from us as a family, I mean, it's a big journey that we've done. Their faith has started to be ignited. It's been amazing to see. They've had so many challenges coming here, so many challenges of so many different things at such a young age, and pluck them out and this and that and start a new life and new friends and all this. But the faith that I'm starting to see in them, it's so rewarding to me. It's wonderful to see. And I want them to have their own relationship. I don't want them to have a relationship with God because I told them to. I want them to have their own deep understanding of their Father. And so every Sunday night afterwards, me and my boys, we just do a devotion. Just me and them. We just talk. It's okay, what is God saying to you? We write it down and we look back, and it's amazing to see how their faith is just starting to be ignited with things, you know, trusting God for things. It's amazing to see. And that's my hope for all of us, if I'm honest. All of us. My hope is that when God comes, that we be still and we know that He is God because we can trust Him and we know that He's a good Father, and that unlike me, when I forgot His goodness in that story that I told at the beginning, like we know that He's going to come through because He's a good Father, and He wants to bless us and He wants to protect us and He wants to provide for us. And so, Lord, I trust You because I know that You've come through before. And so even if my memory's not great, Lord, I want to trust You I know that You're going to come through because You're a good Father. You know, and so if we look at that story, We don't like to wait, but it's not about waiting. It's about pursuing Him, because it's a call to know Him, and there's an activity there. We don't just sit back and wait for Him. When God called me to plant a church in Tampa, I could have just sat back and waited. And do you know what would happen? I'd still be waiting. I have to actively go, but being still in His presence. I can pursue Him, and that's what we need to do when we be still and know that I'm God. Is we need to understand Him and know Him. So the first thing we do, we can learn more about Him. We can learn more about God. So as we be still and not in our own strength and not in our own ideas, we learn more about Him. And so as we study Scripture, we dig deep with Scripture, like we've been doing on Thursday nights. We dig deep with Scripture and trying to understand it a bit more. So we're learning more about God and His goodness and His faithfulness. And so when we open Scripture, we say, Lord, I want to learn more about You in the Scripture. So show me what You want me to do. I'm searching for You now. I'm searching for You. You know, God doesn't play hide and seek with me. He doesn't play hide and seek with you. When you call on Him, He's there. When you seek Him, He is there. He's not saying, oh, I'm going to go hide and seek because You haven't found me for a while. So I'm going to go. No, He's always there. Always there for us. And so we go after Him. We learn more about Him. Then we listen to Him. So we might say, oh, God spoke in Bible times. No, He's still speaking now. I just think we're so busy, we don't hear it. We're so preoccupied with so many different things that we're not listening to His voice. I'm guilty of that as well. There's so many times I'm like, okay, Lord, I'll do it my own way. And if that doesn't work, then I'll come to Your way. You ever do that? I'm going to do this, worry, I'm going to do this. And then that doesn't work. Okay, then I'll go God's way. I think God's called me here, but I think I'm going to do that first. And if that doesn't work, then I'm going to go back to what He wants me to do. No, He's still speaking. Are we listening? Are we Are we so preoccupied with so many other things that we lacking in listening? You know? Sometimes my favorite times with him is just being in the car, nothing on. No music, no message, no nothing, just waiting. Just waiting. And then just start talking to him. Not out of a place of, Lord, can you help me with this and this and this? You know, the prayers that we have, which are good. It's good to pray. God wants us to pray. He wants to cast our burdens onto him. But sometimes I just start by just thanking him. Lord, thank you. All my prayers start off with just thank you. Before I make my request known to him, I just want to thank him. Lord, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for all of this. Thank you for what you're doing. And then just start digging with him and listening to him. What is he saying? So we listen to him. And in those times of listening, while we study scripture or while he's speaking to us, God speaks to us in many different ways. But he comforts us. He might correct us. Maybe we're nervous of listening because we know that there's comes some correction. You know? It's like, you know, like when your kid's done something wrong, they don't want to look at you in the eye. Hey? You ever done that? They don't look you in the eye. You know that they know that you know that they've done something wrong. You know? So they don't look at you in the eye because they know that you're going to correct them or there's going to be punishment or consequences, you know? Or some of us like that with our relationship with God. I don't want to go after him because I'm scared that if I go after him, he's going to ask me to do something that I don't want to do. That thing that I don't want him to know, that thing I don't want it to be exposed, that whatever that thing is, I don't want to go to him because I'm scared that if I do, he's going to reveal that. Even just to me, not to, make sense? So I don't want to go. God's a loving father. When I go to him and I just contend with him, he doesn't come with condemnation. He doesn't come with, why did you lack faith? I felt guilty in that story that I shared at the beginning, not because God made me feel guilty. I felt guilty. God never comes to us and in my life, he doesn't come to rebuke. If there's any condemnation, that's not from him. There's no condemnation from God. But sometimes we are our own worst enemy. We feel like God can't love someone like me. God loves you regardless. Loves you the way you are. And that for me, when I've realized the extent that he loves me, that just helps me to inspire me to go after him even more. If he can love someone like me, he can love all of us. You know, if he can help change someone like me, there's hope for everyone else. And so we listen and then we lean on him. We lean upon him. Lord, your understanding. We lean upon you. We trust in you. We say, Lord, not my will be done, but your will be done. And so we lean on his own understanding. This is what it says in Lamentations 3:25. It says, the Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. Then in Isaiah 64, verse 4, it says, from of old no one has heard or perceived by the ear, no eye has seen a God besides you who acts for those who wait for him. And so you might say, but one, how do I wait? What must I do? Well, you just be still and know that he is God, that he is in control, that he's going to lead you and guide you. This isn't just something to sit back and wait, but this is an active pursuit of him. Rather than anything else that we do, it's an active pursuit of him. And he gives us his ability to do so many things in our lives. What a joy it is. And so we do everything that we do it for the glory of him. Everything that we do, whatever work you do, wherever you find yourself, you do it to his glory. You know, what an amazing gift that he's given us to do everything that we do to the glory of him. And I know it's tough sometimes, but I'm just loving what he is showing us and his heart towards us. It's just, you say, Warren, just be still and know that I am God. Amazing things happen for those that wait on him. If you think of Abraham. Abraham in the promised land. I mean, he went into the promised land and started and it was amazing. But before that, he was just wandering in the desert. And God was building that utter dependence on him. Think of Joseph. Joseph would lead the Egyptians. He was prime minister, basically, and he helped, you know, save a nation and all the rest of it. But before that, when he was sold to slavery and he was in prison, God was building this dependence on him in the jail, in slavery, this dependence on him. Right? So God did a good work, and he did a great work before, and he's doing a great work afterwards. Think of Moses. Moses standing at the Red Sea. He's standing there, and God parts the Red Sea. It's amazing what happens, and he leads the Israelites. But before that, he was just wandering in the desert. Just God was building his relationship with him in exile. Moses for me is such a fascinating character because he was quite young and brash. You know, he killed someone, he hit him, and all that. And so, And then after being exiled and in the, you know, he sees the bush, and it says that he turned. He saw this bush and he sees it, he just turns towards it. And he hears God, and he says, no, not me. I'm not worthy. So from being like this young, arrogant, just, I'll do whatever I want to do, to being, I'm not worthy. Like that heart change. I think that's the reason why God used him, is because it wasn't about him anymore. It's about what God's doing through him. Think of David. David would lead the army. Israel, amazing, right? All of that. But before that, God was doing this work, and he was in the cave hiding from Saul. You see, we want the end result, don't we? We want the end result of this is the fruit that God wants. This is what I want my life to be. But we don't want to wait. We don't want to be still, because that's what I want. And so, but God does so much work in the waiting. He does so much work in the times where life might be hard. Can I tell you something? Sometimes when life is hard, we see it as a punishment from God. Does it happen in your life? It happened in my life. When my life was tough, I thought God was punishing me because I didn't hear him, or I didn't have faith in him. I thought he was I thought whatever, you know. And those are those moments that God is wanting us to be still. I heard the story the other day of this guy that when he was young, his life was hard. Like basically he raised himself. He did no AC, no electricity, you know, like life was hard. But when I was hearing the story and the man that this guy's become, I was, God allowed it to happen to build the person that he is now. Does that make sense? So that perseverance, that grit that you have, in the time we might think it's tough, because it is tough. No one wants things to be tough. But afterwards, when we look back and we say, okay, God was building something in me that I couldn't have built unless I had to go through that. And so I know in my life, I'm not relating my life in any way to any of those biblical characters that we just talked about. But before I'm an African missionary coming to America to plant a church, I was a man who was completely broken. I was a man who was failing at all things. I felt like I was failing as a husband, as a father, as a Christian, as an entrepreneur. Nothing was going right. But you know what? God in that moment was molding me into his image. He was molding me. He was breaking me down so that he could build me up to be more like him. He was bringing me to a place of utter dependence on him. A friend of ours in Atlanta, he shares the same thing. I thought I was coming to Tampa to start a church, right? More than that, I was coming to know God on a deeper level that I don't know if I would have ever got if I stayed in Johannesburg. My relationship with him, while was good, I was coasting. Life was easy, so I didn't have to have a level of faith that I need to have now. I didn't have to trust him like I do now, because life was easy. Life was good. Life was comfortable. But he, since coming here to this amazing country, that I've got such a deep love for this country and the people, most of you. No, I'm kidding. But he brought me here to show me more of himself that I don't know if I would have gotten elsewhere. And that's totally changed the person that I want to become. It's totally changed what's important to me. It's totally changed the outcome that the vision that I have for my life is totally different now. And what a wonderful gift that is, isn't it, friends? What a wonderful gift. When we trust him, when we come to a place of utter dependence on him, and we say, I don't know how the journey looks. You might say, well, I don't know how the journey looks. I don't know how to be still. I don't know how to know him. I don't know. Just seek him and be still in his presence, and he reveals more and more. And as we step out and trust him, and as we go after him, and he reveals more and more of himself. You know, like now I never used to crave the presence of my Father like I've never had before. I just want to spend time with him all the time. I just want to seek him. I feel like a kid at Christmas. You know what I mean? It's like I get another present. That's awesome. Like every day I want to spend time with him. That's my challenge for all of us. Spend time with him. Seek him. He's always there. We might, you know, maybe we go to a place and we think, I don't know if God will show up, or I don't know if he's going to answer. God is always there. He's always speaking. He's always present. Think about the prodigal son. The father was there just waiting for the son to come back. He was just waiting. The son had to go do what he had to do, but he was waiting and probably praying and wishing that he comes back. When he comes back, they have this big celebration. I think our Father in heaven is just waiting for us to be still and to know that He is God. And so whatever you're facing, whatever struggle that you're facing, whatever journey that you're on, whatever trial that you're facing, whatever big prayers that you've got, start it with just be still and be with His presence, because God will come through. He always does. He always has. He always will. It might look different to how we want it to, but His ways are higher than our ways. I mean, if I had to have a title for this message, it would just be God Wins. Relax. Right? He wins. He wins. Sometimes I wish previously that He would win in the way that I want Him to win. Like, I wish that He would answer the prayers that I want Him, the way that He wants it to answer my prayers. But now I'm just like, Lord, I know You're in control. I know You're going to come through. I know that You're going to provide. I know that You're going to answer these prayers. I know that all that, I don't know how You're going to do it. And I, do you know what it's like? My prayers are different now in a lot of ways. Lord, this is this is what I would humbly ask You to do. But Lord, even if You don't, remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Like, our God can. Maybe I must do a preach on this. Our God can, He will, but even if He doesn't, we're okay with it. That's my prayers now. Lord, I know that You're going to come through. Like, I pray that You come through. I'm going to seek You. But you know what? Even if You don't come through in that, I'm okay, because Your ways are higher than my ways. So even if You don't answer my prayers, I know that Your ways are higher than my ways. So if You don't answer it my way, the other way is better. You know what I mean? So I don't go to Him with like a shopping list of what He needs to answer, but I'm going to Him just saying, like, Lord, Your will be done. So this is what I want to do now. We're going to sing it, but I'm going to play the video. It's a song, and it's called Be Still. And I really want us to not rush this. I want us to just spend time with our Father. And maybe some of you want to just, you know, you can sing with it. Maybe some of you want to just close your eyes. Maybe some of you want to stand and raise your hands. Whatever you want to do, just be in a place of just focusing on Him. Don't worry about anyone else. This is just, I wanted to have time where you can just spend time with your Father. And just go seek Him. Maybe while we're singing, you pray to Him. Maybe while we're singing, you raise your hands, or you just, you see things in your life that you need to hand over to Him. Maybe while we're singing, the Holy Spirit is revealing things in your life that you need to hand over. Whatever it is, the Holy Spirit will speak to you. Because I'm expectant that He will. But I just want us to spend time to just be still and seek Him. So Father, I just thank You. I thank You just for everything that You're doing, Lord. I just thank You for this wonderful opportunity, Lord, to be part of Your kingdom, Lord, to be a shepherd, to lead Your church, Father. I'm just so grateful for what You're doing, Lord. I'm humbled. I'm always so humbled by the fact that You would choose someone like me, Father. I just pray for this morning that as we sing this song together, I just pray, Lord, that we will just come with an attitude of being still, an attitude of just of seeking You, an attitude of just resting in Your presence. So Father, I pray for this time, Lord. I pray for this holy moment, that You will just speak to us. Thank You, Father. Amen.
Before our usher teams come forward to receive our tithes and offerings and response cards, here's a few important things happening with our CE family.
Here at CE, it's a place where we don't take ourselves too seriously, but we take our faith seriously. Another thing we take seriously is growing in our relationship with Jesus. If this is you, then check out our Growth Class. Growth Class will equip you with the steps you can take to experience more in your walk with Jesus and help you get more connected within our CE family. Lunch and childcare will also be provided. So let us know if you're interested in attending our next Growth Class on Sunday, the 3rd of March. Write Growth Class on your response card. As our ushers come forward to collect our response cards and receive our tithes and offering, your faithfulness in giving of your tithes and offering each week allows our CE family and guests to be well served each week, our communities to be changed through the gospel, and God's kingdom to be expanded. One of the easiest ways to consistently give is by establishing recurring giving online or on the CE app. Every gift makes a huge difference, as our tithes and offering are fueling the message of hope through Jesus Christ to many people.
Thank you so much for being on mission with us to help more people experience full life in Jesus Christ.
dance through the darkness, sing through the fire, praise when it don't make sense. Sometimes you gotta stare down the giants, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all the praise. Sometimes you gotta praise in the prison, cry out to heaven, shout it till the doors swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all the praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all the praise. I'll praise you anywhere, on mountains, in valleys, I know that you're with me there. I'll praise you anywhere.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. I hope you're leaving encouraged. I hope your spirit's refreshed and God's working in your life in a new way. And man, it's gonna be a great week ahead. I'm hoping that for you. I'm believing that for you. And so whatever you have in front of you, just remember what you learned today. Remember what God did and take that with you throughout the week. Because look, God doesn't stay here in this service. He's going with you everywhere you go. So let's get after it. Let's go into this week ahead. And by the way, if you have any questions from today's service, if you have any comments or prayer requests, if there's anything we can do to help you, I want to encourage you to go to our website, fill out that form. You can even scan the QR code right here and just let us know how we can help, how we can serve you. We would love to be more of a part of your life. Love to help you get connected. And by the way, if you want to go to our website or our social media, there's other opportunities where you can learn more about Church Experience. You can learn how to be involved. But man, either way, we're just so happy that we get to be a part of your life. And I hope that this week, God is a part of everything that you do. Thanks again for joining us. See you next weekend.